Here is put on your mental radar some very interesting resource that's been published on GitHub recently. You might ask the question, why PayPal? And so this is all about REST API standards. I mean, we all design or use, or when we are, whether we want it or not, whether we know it or not, we take decisions with regard to our REST APIs. And whenever we have a question, we go to Stack Overflow or whatever resource, whatever book. And so the standards, the mental standards we have in our minds are pretty piecemeal. And the good thing is that PayPal, 1.5 years ago, have published an absolutely extraordinary standard. And you have absolutely everything you need to know here. So I really encourage you to study this this resource. It's easy to read. It's comprehensive. You have pretty much everything. It's intuitive. There's the right amount of detail, so it's not like reading these 400-page books with all the stuff you don't need to know. And its format, it's really something easy to share between your team members, and it's really something that that you can easily embed in your organizational culture. I mean, you can link to different pages of the standards depending on. I mean, to document the reason why you're taking this or that decisions. And you can extend it, but that's something that you will not often have to do. So it comes in two parts. The first part is the guidelines. The second part is a set of design patterns and use cases. So a few words about the guidelines. An interesting checklist of service design principles. That's things we know intuitively, but it's nice to have this checklist and be able to say, okay, I meet this loose coupling, encapsulation, stability, etc. Of course, and that's really the core of REST API. It's a proper use of HTTP verbs, status codes, and the proper way to use 200 something return codes, 400, 500, etc. Proper use of headers as well. And you will discover some really interesting stuff that probably you don't know about how to use accept content or the caching. Caching is a fairly hairy concept in REST API design. Hetios link, that's something really, really important. And if you haven't heard of it, I encourage you to study it. And this is the idea that in your response, in the response to a REST request, you will include a number of links of what the user of the resource can do afterwards. So typically, if you do a GET request on a resource, you will provide other links to other possible actions on this particular resource that was in the context of your request. Naming conventions, and here, perhaps noticeably, PayPal has introduced the concept of a namespace. This is very simple idea, but it proved to be very, very useful. And this is a way to group your resources into a consistent visual namespace. Concept of immutable even identifiers. I mean, that's probably something you know, but never use something like, let's say, an auto-increment database as an identifier. Error handling. PayPal has designed an error JSON format. That's something you can load up in your Open API design environment. API versioning, so that's the proper way of versioning your API. And then different types of API capability, experience API, process API. That's probably so. Design patterns, so you will find pretty much all the answers to your patterns, the patterns you need to know. Search type patterns can be pretty complex, so that's something useful. Asynchronous operations as well, so that's when you don't want to wait until the response of your service, but you have to return something. Controller patterns, that's for posting for something which is not a resource, like a process operation, like a simulation calculation, fall into this category. And finally, I will mention something which are not there and by design. So error handling on complex operations, that's something that your organization might have a preferred way to do. The security context, security is by design not included in the PayPal API. unique request ID, that's Iniquitous ID, I mean, this is the idea of you want an ID in your HTTP header to be able to track a request end to end from different legs. Sensitive resource ID, that's a really interesting one, and I will close on this one. This is when you don't want in a GET request to have the identifier of your resource. A very good example here is credit card number. You don't want to get to have a GET credit card slash and your credit card number for PCI DSS reasons. There's no good solution to that problem, unfortunately. An interesting quirk that we can mention here about the HTTP protocol is that you can have a payload in your GET request, and that's provided by the standard. Unfortunately, most of your implementations will not allow you to use it because it kind of fell on the wayside, so you won't be able to use it. Versioning also, if you're not happy to have your version number in the API, you can put it somewhere else, typically in the HTTP header. So just remember, this is really, really good. Use it.